If you're trying to create e-learning that's more engaging and effective, or if you're just trying to become an instructional designer, then you should learn more about how to apply Mayer's principles for multimedia learning. So Mayer's principles are research-backed and science-driven. So by applying these to your e-learning projects, it's a really safe way to make them more engaging and effective. I'm gonna be giving a primer here, but a really good way to learn more about this and learn more about the science behind e-learning and multimedia learning is in this book right here, eLearning and the Science of Instruction, and this is by Clark and Mayer. So definitely check that book out. I will link it below. But that dives into the research and the boundaries of how you can apply these principles. But for now, let's take a look at each of them and talk about how you can start applying them today to your e-learning projects. So first up, we have the Multimedia Principle. So this one says that you should use words and graphics instead of words alone. So the idea here is that you can use visuals to enhance the learning experience and kind of show people instead of just telling them. Mayer makes some distinctions between graphics that are there to decorate the page or just to represent something. So for example, if you're talking about how to pump a bike tire, including a picture of a pump, maybe not super useful. But instead, Clark and Mayer say to include graphics that help people understand and organize information. So, you know, like conceptual organizers where you're showing how information relates to other information, or, you know, diagrams of how things actually work, if that's what it is that you want people to understand, or process diagrams where you're showing step one, step two, step three. Like, those are the type of graphics that are most useful. So that's the Multimedia Principle. Make good use of graphics. Next up, we have the Contiguity Principle. So this says that you should align words to the graphics that they describe. So this is aligning in time and space. So you'll see what I mean. So spatial contiguity, so we wanna put the labels for things very close to whatever it is that we're labeling. And I'll show an example of that right on the next screen. But there's also temporal contiguity, and that says that we should explain the graphic or animation as it's occurring. So instead of, you know, showing someone an animation and then afterwards explaining what happened, that, you know, we're putting the explanation like far away from what we're actually showing them, even though it's right after. Instead, we should show them what's happening, and as it's happening, we explain what's happening and why. So we don't want to just like show someone a visual and then, you know, separate that from the labeling or the explanation. We want to do those things at the same time or as close as possible. So here's an example of how this plays out spatially. So this is just some random little widget or whatever that I made. So if we wanted to label these blue pieces, this is a common mistake, and you might see this a lot in textbooks or online or in different places, but we label things with maybe different letters or different numbers, and then you have to look off to the side and look at the key to see what it is that's going on. So I'll look at the triangle, I'll see, okay, that's A, and then I look over at the key and say, okay, that's the regulator. Same thing with B. Oh yeah, where's B? Oh, that's the modulator. So that's fine, but that adds cognitive load because people have to continuously go back and forth searching for what it is that we're labeling or what that thing actually is. Yeah. So instead, if you're following the contiguity principle, you're just going to put these labels closely to what it is that they are labeling. So there are other applications of this. Again, check out the book I recommended, but just start keeping an eye on these things. Like feedback is another example. Rather than putting feedback on like a separate screen after someone answers the question, you know, just keep that feedback as close as possible to the answer and the question so that people can quickly reference it and they don't have to spend time searching for it. So there we have it. Next up, we have the modality principle. So this says that you should describe graphics with narration rather than on-screen text. So if we're looking at a graphic, we don't want a big text explanation. It's more effective if you can narrate what's going on with that graphic, especially if it's like an animation. And the idea for this is that we don't want to overload the visual channel. So this is a cognitive information processing principle saying, you know, Your visual channel is one thing, what you're looking at, and your auditory channel is another. So if you're hearing that narration, that's going in through your ears, and if you're looking at the visual, that's coming in through your eyes. So it's less cognitive load overall, since those two channels are handling those two different tasks. If you want someone to be paying attention to a graphic while you're, you know, presenting text to them, then they're kind of scanning back and forth, trying to pay attention to both, and that can add to the cognitive load and make it easier to miss things. Clark and Mayer do make a distinction here, saying that if the words are complex or unfamiliar, or really technical or really important that you bring attention to them, you may want to show the words on the screen. So again, if it's this jargon that people aren't familiar with, you may want to spend some time showing those words so that they can, get a mental picture of those words, see how they're spelled, and just retain that a little better. That's the idea there. But overall, modality principle, use narration when you're describing graphics, not on screen text. Oh, and one final point, like obviously the budget is, if you're doing a text-based e-learning project and you don't have access to narration, you have to make do with what you've got. But if you can narrate those graphics or animations, even better. All right, the redundancy principle. This one is closely related. It says to explain visuals with narration or text, but not both. So we don't need to have this visual graphic here with narration and with text running on the side. Like, I see this mistake a lot. I've seen a lot of e-learning. And some e-learning people just want to, you know, they'll have their visuals, they'll have paragraphs, and then they'll have voiceover just reading the paragraph. That violates this principle and makes for a not very good learning experience. So the idea here is don't add text to the screen when narrating graphics. Again, with the same exception, if it's an unfamiliar word or very important phrase or concept, you can highlight that. But otherwise, just avoid it. You can narrate the graphics just fine. And again, if you're not using narration, that's fine. Again, text or narration, not both. That's the idea with the redundancy principle. All right, getting into the coherence principle. So if you're an experienced or somewhat experienced instructional designer, this one is probably going to be pretty intuitive, but adding extraneous material can hurt learning or negatively impact the learning experience. So extraneous in this case, it just means unnecessary or unrelated. So avoid that unnecessary information and don't include any distracting graphics. Okay, so if the visual will distract from what's going on with the learning experience, don't include it. Not a good idea. And again, if you've seen my video about creating good learning objectives, you'll know that you want every single part of your learning experience to be aligned with those objectives. And if it's not supporting one of those objectives, get rid of it. So I'll link that video below and in a card in the top right of this video. So check that one out. But as long as you're keeping everything aligned to your learning objectives, you're probably not going to violate this coherence principle. All right, this one right here is my favorite. This is the personalization principle. So the idea with this one is to use a conversational style, a human voice, and polite wording. So the idea is that you're emulating a human-to-human conversation. So rather than, you know, using textbook speak, like you don't want to use this academic, formal textbook language. You want to use conversational language, like you're talking to your friend or something, because there's a lot of research showing that people learn better when it's that conversational tone. So again, I recommend checking out the book, but conversational tone is what you want to go for. That's the main takeaway with this principle. And it pairs very nicely with the embodiment principle, which says that you should use on-screen coaches and characters to present this information, relate to the learner, help the learner navigate tough situations, or maybe even giving feedback. So I love using these mentor characters in the learning experiences I develop, who you can turn to when you need help answering a question, because it hits on this embodiment and this personalization principle really well. When you have this like peer or mentor character giving you this feedback I usually use these characters to give feedback, but when they're giving you this feedback in this conversational tone, I think it makes a big impact, and it's very different from, oh no, try again, you got it wrong for this reason. Well, that's kind of personalized, oh no, try again, but you get where I'm coming from. And Clark and Mayer say that with this principle, it doesn't need to be some realistic photo of a person. Illustrated coaches and characters work just as well. So completely okay to use illustrations. All right, the segmenting principle. So this one, again, should be pretty familiar to instructional designers, but the idea is that we're breaking one continuous lesson into bite-sized segments so that we're not overwhelming someone all at once. So me applying this principle would probably be to do an individual video on each one of these principles and dive deeper into the examples rather than just giving this one 10-minute or so video where I throw it all at you at once, but it is what it is. So the idea is you had a chunk the information and the lessons and the content based on the learner's background knowledge and the complexity of the content. So rather than trying to fit everything into a 1 hour session, splitting that up into, you know, 12 5-minute sessions or experiences may be much more effective, especially if the content is more complex. All right, pre-training principle. This one I don't see leveraged as well as it could be, but the idea is to introduce key terms and concepts before the learning experience. So you might give someone a one-page handout or something where you have key terms listed, maybe give a little bit of context, and just orient the person to what it is that they might be learning. And then when they show up to that learning experience, whether it's online or in person, they're a bit more primed for the experience, and they're not going, the idea is that there won't be as much cognitive load when you're using those terms and discussing those concepts in the experience, because the person has already been pre-trained on them, so they can focus more on what it is that they have to actually accomplish. So this is a very good one to take advantage of if you are able to do so. All right, and the signaling principle. So the idea here is to guide attention with visual cues. So this can be highlighting things, like here's the example. We underlined it, we had an arrow pointing to it. It can be highlighting, you know, zooming in on things, having a glow around them. But I mean, it's pretty self-explanatory. You want to add these little cues to direct people's attention to whatever it is that they should be paying attention to. All right, and that is all I have for you. I hope that you enjoyed this video, and if you did, please go ahead and like it and drop a comment letting me know. If you're watching this because you want to become an instructional designer, go ahead and check out my full guide to becoming an instructional designer, which again, I will link below. And thank you for watching to the end. I will see you in the next video.